So we'll get started. It's 6:02. So guys, welcome to the Power Hour every week. Patty and I are here giving value, right? So this week is no different. We are going to light up the fire once again with Bobby Davidowitz. And Bobby, I've known you for 2 years now. You're a great inspiration. And today it's going to be no different with you talking about mastermind. And you've been in the business for like about 20 years or so, or a little bit more.
Yeah.
And I've heard your story a couple of times, and I think that alone is an amazing story and your mindset. So guys, let's welcome Bobby, and Bobby, take it away.
Absolutely. So you want me just kind of give a little background story?
I will give it a little background and then talk about mindset, and then we can open up some Q&A at the end.
Yeah. So about 20 years ago, completely by accident, I got into the mortgage industry. So, you know, I had graduated college, you know, like many college students, kind of lost. And, you know, like I was actually telling some of the agents today, it was like, you know, I did all the things that I thought were the right thing, you know, got the good grades, did all that. So nobody ever really questioned like what your future plans were. And then like I graduated from college and I'm like, oh my God, I have no future plans. Like I really didn't, you know, have a great plan. And I started to freak out. Right. And the one thing that I knew in my heart, I was like, you know what? I want to be in the entertainment business. That was actually the first thing that I was like, man, I want to be like an actor. I want to go to acting school. I want to do all these things. And I started to do that kind of stuff. And I actually started to work at a nightclub. And then eventually the nightclub life, I don't know if any of you guys work in a nightclub, but you know, that's a rough life. You know what I mean? Like, you know, you're coming home at 5-6 in the morning, you're hanging out. And I was just like, at one point I was like, that's it. You know, at this point I'm like 21, 22 years old, I'm 42 now. So, you know, I met a guy who was starting a branch of a mortgage company, and I was so ready to like be in the business world that I was like, dude, whatever mortgages are, I want to do it. Like, I don't care. I don't even care what it was. And so I kind of got in the mortgage business by accident around 22 years old and, you know, kind of worked my way up. Very shortly after that, I partnered with a gentleman. He was the president of the company that I was at, and he was like fighting with the actual owner of the company. So he was like, hey, Bob, you want to open up a mortgage company? And I'm like, yeah, sure. Like, I had no idea how to run a business or anything. I was like, this is just a natural progression. You just go from like mortgage broker to owning a mortgage company. And we did that 3-4 years, kind of learned the bumps and bruises. And it's funny how, you know, how I believe that everything in life trains you for what you're doing now, right? It's like, there is no wasted experience if you do this right. Right. And it's funny because that was the first time that I learned the lesson that being the owner, the broker, or the mortgage brokerage was not something actually that I really wanted. Like, I didn't know that. I just kind of thought, well, being a business owner is the next logical step. And let me get my mortgage brokerage license. And what I found myself doing was, you know, hiring, firing, CFO. I got 20 new jobs. And I wasn't getting paid much more. I was still having to produce and do all these other things. So sure enough, you know, we know what happened in the market crash, right? We started to see the signs of it happening. And, you know, my business partner at the time didn't see it happening. He was kind of a, you know, cocky, and he was like, oh yeah, everything's going to be fine. And I was like, I don't think so, man. I'm like, you know, the finances are going down. And I actually gave him the company and just left real estate altogether. And sure enough, the market crashed after that. I went off and did kind of my passion, right? I had been doing stuff in entertainment. I got into marketing and branding, video production, which once again, your experiences are the culmination of your experiences kind of train you for what we do today. And sure enough, so I got all this, you know, practice in the marketing, branding space, content creation. I was filming documentaries. I filmed reality shows. I did all sorts of stuff. Couldn't really figure out how to monetize it until I worked for my buddy's marketing and branding agency. Worked with him. He's based out of Orlando, but has entrepreneur clients all over the world. So I was able to work on the marketing, branding, and building the stories of entrepreneurs. That's what we did. We were a PR agency specifically for entrepreneurs. So I did that for a few years, made some good money. And one thing that I did really smart was start to be very strategic about the opportunities that I had. When I went and worked for my buddy, I was like, look, I'm here to make money, but I'm here to make money to put aside as a cushion. So in case I have to pivot again, I'm not making a desperation move, right? I'm not making I got to get a job or I'm going to be broke next week. I saved my money up and said, hey, look, if there's ever a pivot, I'm not going to make a desperation decision. And sure enough, it came a point where there wasn't really much growth opportunity where I was at. And I was like, okay, I'm searching for the next thing. But at this point, I'm in my mid-30s and I'm like, look, whatever I choose next has to be the fit. like I can't be hopping from one thing to another. Like I have to commit to something that's going to be my vehicle. And funny enough, like I've had my license in 2005 back when I was a mortgage broker, and I didn't actually entertain being a realtor. Like I had the license and I was doing, you know, I'd done a few investments, but in my mind, I was like, oh, I'm not really a realtor. You know, I don't want to be a realtor, that kind of thing. And sure enough, about 6 months after I got out of the branding agency, a buddy of mine calls me up and says, hey, we're starting up an investment company, a wholesaling company. I got some investors to back us. Would you want to do this? And I was like, brother, I think I've been waiting for this call. Like, you know, real estate is one of the only industries where you can control your time and your destiny. And I was like, dude, this has been staring me in the face the whole time. So I kind of got in through wholesaling, figured out that through wholesaling, I was getting a bunch of seller leads. And I was like, wait, like most of these people aren't going to accept a wholesale offer, but they're raising their hand saying, I want to sell my home. And I was like, wait, hold on. I can turn these into listings. So I started to do that. And I was like, I still was like, I'm not going to be a realtor. So I'm like, I need to go find another realtor who will list these properties for me. And in that search, I ran into a young lady named Jennifer Encarnacion, which some of you might know. She's part of our crew here in Orlando. And she brought me to this exit real estate office in downtown Orlando. And I had a meeting with her that day. And she kept telling me, you got to meet my broker, Gil. You got to meet my broker, Gil. I was like, look, honey, I don't need to meet the broker. I'm like, I get it. I'm like, I just want to sell some. I want to sell some homes. I want you to help me. And she's like, no, I really think you should meet my broker. And I was like, cool, no problem. But I had such a great vibe in a meeting. And at this point in my life, I was really following my intuition. And I swear to you, it was like a storybook. I left there and 5 minutes later, I'm in the car. And I was like, man, I got such a great vibe at that office. I was like, I'm hanging my license there. And I did that. And 2 weeks later, I meet Gil Ramos, right? And me and Gil sit down at a lunch, and he starts telling me about his vision for the future. I start telling him about my vision for the future. And I'm like, that's where like the bromance started. Like where I was like, man, he's a big thinker. I was like, this guy wants to do big things. And I'm like, I want to do big things. He's Puerto Rican. I'm Puerto Rican. I was like, man, we got so much in common. And sure enough, that's kind of how our relationship started. And we were, like I said, we were a franchise called Exit Realty. And for the next 5 years, I helped Gil and coaching agents. We've developed a good relationship, and we had decided that no matter what, we were going to be business partners at something, but we really didn't know what we were going to do. And sure enough, this guy named Carlos German kept calling up, you know, Gil, like, you got to look at this EXP thing. You got to look at this EXP thing. And Gil's like, I don't want to look at it. I don't want to look at it. But at this point, and this is what they teach us in Agent Attraction, one of the best things that Gene Frederick ever said was, you know, you can't open the gate from the outside, right? Like people have to open their gate from the inside. But when the gate comes open, you got to be there, right? You got to follow up with folks. So when their gate opens, you will be there. And guess what? Gil's gate was starting to open because his franchise agreement was running out. And Carlos was smart enough to invite Gil and Lorena to Las Vegas to an EXP leadership event. And so I don't know if you guys have met Gil. He's a total deep personality, like, you know, comes off rough sometimes. And he goes and tell Carlos, he's like, listen, you can pay for me and my wife to go to Vegas, but I'm just going to take her on vacation. I'll go to your little timeshare presentation, whatever you're sending me to, but that's what's going to be. And so he goes to Vegas, and, you know, he sees the presentation. He's like, man, this is really interesting. And then he's like, I got to talk to somebody who's doing it big, right? Like in EXP. And he sees this guy in the hallway, happens to be Gene Frederick. He doesn't know it's Gene Frederick, but there's a bunch of people surrounding him. And Gil walks up to him and he's like, hey, man. So I heard first he asked him, he's like, you're making money with this EXP thing? And the guy's like, yeah, I'm making some money with the EXP thing. And Gil's like, I heard there's an app where you can show me the money. And the guy's like, yeah, there's something. There's an app. Yeah. He's like, show me. And the guy's like, well, you know, Gene, you ever met Gene? Gene's like, well, tell me about yourself first. You know, like, let's talk. And Gil's like, I want to see the numbers. Right. And sure enough, Gene showed him the numbers. And you know, Gil looked at Gene and said, hey, you know, I'm not shutting down my brokers for $265,000 a year. And Gene was like, oh, no, that's last month. And he was like, baby, come meet Mr. Gene. And that was like how it all started. And so Gil basically came back, you know, to the thing. He's like, hey, man, I just went to this EXP thing. And if half this stuff is true, man, we got to do this thing. And I was so excited because at that point he was actually thinking about selling the brokerage potentially. And I was like, dude, there's so much potential here. I don't know where this goes. So it just goes to show you that if you commit to it, the best decision I made about 7 years ago was just to commit to real estate. Hey, this is going to be my vehicle. I had no idea EXP was going to show up, but I did know it was my vehicle. Like, I'm just going to work this thing. I'm going to become a great agent. I'm going to get into commercial real estate. I became a coach. I did all that stuff. And then the culmination of all those experiences, this EXP thing shows up. And I was like, oh my gosh, this is it. This was the thing that I was actually waiting to do. And sure enough, you know, Gil and I partnered up on that. That was about 2.5 years ago. We went from 70 agents. Now I just looked at the rev group. It's at 1200. So, you know, 70 to 1200 in 2.5 years. We in the business side call that scaling, and it's very, very exciting. So that is the long and the short of it. And, I did coach agents for 4 years. Now I have a team of coaches. So now I'm really focused on building the team, building the organization as a whole. And then Gil and I have a leads team together as well that help manage and coach. The end.
This is just the beginning.
Team. I don't know. The questions come up.
I would say let's dive a little bit on that growth mindset that we as agents need to always have, you know, not just getting a license and you're okay, that's it, I'm going to go, you know, do real estate now. Having that growth mindset that you always have to be learning. You always have to, you know, learn what's going on, know your skill, you know, get better every day, you know, and that's something that you coach as well. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah. I mean, in general, we talked about this before we got on, which is, look, personal development has to be the foundation of what you do. Like, you have to at some point become a junkie of personal development. What does that mean? That means reading success books. That means listening to the YouTube videos, the podcasts. You have to, because here's the deal. When we're born, what happens is I feel like we have this computer, right? And then people start plugging programs into it, but they're not our programs. Right? There are either programs people are trying to make you believe, or because of the trauma or the situations you grew up with, you create a story and becomes a program that runs in you, right? Society has its own programs. You know what I'm saying? Telling you, hey, you know, remember they used to say, hey, you got to go to college. You got to get a degree. That's how you're going to be successful and be a good job. That isn't even close to true now. Now, some people do. Like, if you want to be a doctor, of course, but most people are now saddled with debt and have a degree that they don't even use, right? That was a societal program that we just followed like robots into it. I did it. That's why I know, because I did that and realized, dude, at 18 years old, I had no clue what I was going to do with my life. And I spent all that money going to a school to get a piece of paper that I don't use. So all that being said is we have to take control of the programs, right? We have to wipe that hard drive clean, and we have to start feeding ourselves the things that are going to empower us, the things that are going to let you grow. And, you know, as Tony Robbins says, success leaves clues. You know, people are condensing their map into a book that took 20 years, 30 years of experience to create. Why wouldn't you read that book, right? Why wouldn't you advance yourself that? So for me, that was kind of a foundational thing. To be quite honest with you, in the last 5 years, it's kicked up to a whole new level. You know, I used to kind of force myself to read stuff, force myself to listen to stuff. Now I'm having trouble forcing myself to listen to music in the car, you know, because I've become such a fan of what it's done for me in my life that I know how important it is. And now in coaching agents for, you know, 4 or 5 years now, I realize it's really the only thing, right? Like, with the right mindset, people figure things out, but I could give you $1 million plan on how to make money in real estate right now on this call. And if you go home and tell yourself you're not worth a shit, you're not going to do a dang thing. You're not going to do a thing, because you don't even think you deserve the success that would come from putting that work in. So when I say it's foundational, I really mean it. I really mean that it doesn't matter, because even if you get success and you don't have the foundation, you will find a way to self-sabotage. You will find a way. You will find a way to be unhappy. You will find how many people we know that are doing incredibly well and are miserable, right? Like, they're absolutely miserable because they never solved the old program. They thought they could achieve their way out of the program, right? Like maybe if I do enough things, I will feel worthy. No, that's not kind of how it works. You kind of feel worthy, and then you got to build on that foundation. And that's why I preach it so much, because now studying all the stuff that I study, I realize it's really the only thing, because that's what frustrates us. I mean, you guys are all leaders, right? Like, you guys ever brought somebody in and you're like, you got so much potential and you're spending all this time with them and they still leave, or they don't do the work, and you're thinking, is this person lazy? And they're not lazy. They're working on old programming, and it doesn't matter what you tell them. They don't believe they deserve it. They don't believe they're worth it. So they come home and they start running a bunch of stories in their mind, and they don't take the action they're supposed to take. So that's kind of my overall feel about how important it is. I don't think it's a thing that, you know, like we talked about it before, Patty, you were like, oh, I'm totally a personal development person. I'm like, I totally don't think you have a choice. Like, you don't. You have to continue to scoop out the garbage that everybody gives you every single day. That's why you have to wake up. You're saying you were doing the miracle morning. To me, that it's like cleaning out, you know, it's cleaning out the lint filter in the drying machine. It's like, you gotta do that every single day and every single morning, or society's going to keep giving you crap and you're going to be like, wait, is that true? I mean, and that's why I'm such a big believer.
Yeah. Amen. I totally agree. I mean, I can tell the difference. And like you said, you really don't have a choice, but you don't have a choice if you want to succeed. I think when I'm not making the choice to take the time to read those books or listen to those audio, or, you know, making time for me to get the fitness on in the morning and, you know, just getting that positive mindset, I could tell the difference. I'm not as productive. I will, you know, sit around more. My checklist isn't getting checked off. I mean, you can really tell the difference. And I think a lot of people fall into that category. And like you said, you know, you can kind of lead a horse to water, you know, but you can't make them drink. And I think a lot of the reasoning behind that is because their mindset isn't in the right place to take action when you give them these ideas. So I completely agree. And I think that is the demise of a lot of agents and just mm-hmm. a lot of people in general.
Yeah. And you just got to keep them in the fold and support. I mean, I've seen many people turn things around, even people that I didn't think would turn it around. They do, as long as you can keep them close to the family. I mean, because what we built here, the culture that we built is so strong that, it, you know, I talked to an agent the other day. I was like, look, man, I know you're going through it, but do me a favor. Like, don't leave here, because you're around the right people, man. Like, we're committed to growth. We're committed to your personal development. Like, I understand that some people's natural reaction because things aren't going well is maybe I just need to change the scenery. Well, the only problem with that is they're going to show up in the next place and they're going to realize, oh, it wasn't the scenery. It was something that I had to change from the inside out. Right. So we've actually had several agents leave and come back. That happens a lot, actually, you know, not a lot, but, you know, a couple notable ones that have left and then realized, oh, wow, like I went to another culture and there wasn't any. And then they came back to it. So yeah, that's
it. I'm amazed. I mean, so I was in real estate 24 years before I came over to eXp, which has just been a little over a year now. And it is amazing just how my mindset has changed in that little over a year. You know, it, mm-hmm. I mean, I was all kind of like, okay, it's mine. I worked hard for it and nobody else is allowed in. And everybody else had that same mentality. And that's what I was used to for so long. So to change that mindset that you've been wired to have for so long I don't want to say it's hard when you're around the right people mm-hmm. with the right culture, the right mindsets, it's a lot easier to mm-hmm. change that, mm-hmm. but it's been amazing. I feel like I'm a totally different person in that year.
Yeah. And it still takes but at the end of the day, it still takes a personal decision, right? No matter it, even being around the right people is not enough. At some point you got to realize it's like, this ain't going to change until I decide to do something different. And as long as people stick around long enough to make that decision, with our crew, you know, like, you guys already know, I mean, you know, Rebecca, Josue, you know, you got Carlos, you got Veronica, you got our crew in Orlando. And it's like, I think eXp as a company is formed around the concept of collaboration. But what we've done is something that was very intentional and very different I also get at least one call a month from an agent that joined a different line, you know, and they're like, I wish I knew you guys existed. And so that's a kudos to you guys and the things that you guys have all built together and the culture you guys have built, because people are realizing that, you know, it matters also who you're with because of that, the people you surround yourself and because of the growth culture and the growth mentality, this is the growth model. So you want to be around people who think bigger, and that's the next level. The next step, the first step is, okay, I'm past the point that I don't think I'm worth it. I'm doing everything for the right reasons. Then the next step is how do we get you guys to think bigger, like way bigger, you know? And that's what McGill and I at this stage of what we're doing is what we're really excited about, is identifying leaders who are now starting to be like, oh, wait, I can do this thing. And they're just starting to get it. I saw a lot of people shift mindsets when we went to the Dallas Build Conference. You know, they came back and they saw people on stage who didn't seem any more talented than they were, that were in other states, and they never heard of them on stage speaking about their numbers and about the organizations that they grew and about the production, like from high level producers to people who were, you know, building $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 a month residual incomes. And people are like, oh, wow, that I'm not that far away from that. And it was just seeing that that was enough for them to be like, all right, guys, I just expanded my mind to what could be possible, you know, and we're excited to see there's multiple people in our office opening countries. Like that's the kind of big I want you guys to think, like you guys connections in other countries, we can open them. Like you could be the first person. Like that's some big thinking stuff right there. So yeah. Anyway.
You know, let me tell you, on mindset, when I came over, I was seeing all these big top producers, you know, Veronica and just different people like that. And I was thinking, I'm too old to get that from where I am to where she is. Like, and within 2 years, I was just like, I was so like amazed. And at first I gotta say, I was a little like, wow, that's a lot. You know what I mean? Do I got to keep up with, you know, the Joneses, you know what I mean? And so my mindset wasn't focused. It wasn't where it needed to be. I kind of think it was a culture shock at the beginning. And then you wonder, can I do this? Because you're not used to having that mindset of absolutely, you can do anything you put your mind to and surround yourself with those you want to be like, and ask questions and be present. And, you know, I join everything I can Monday. That's all I do. I do the accountability, the momentum Monday. I do these training sessions. I have our team meetings. Everything is like on Monday. That is like my, you know, fill your brain up with everything you could possibly learn to be better Monday, so that the week just kind of is on a roll. It starts out and then just kind of rolls from there. So how about you, Lisset? What do you do to get your week on?
Same thing. And, you know, just wanted to touch upon Bobby a little bit about what you touched upon. Like some people move here and there and they're thinking, oh, it's the company. Oh, it's the business. Oh, it's, and, you know, you touched upon the fact that it's inside of them, that mindset, right? That we are our economy. And that's what I kind of try to tell everybody, that if you don't come along on those Mondays and doing the things that you got to do, plug in with everything, if you're not plugging in and you're not connecting and you're not collaborating and you're not learning, that you're not going to get it. And you're going to be hopping from company to company until eventually you realize that you're the problem. So talking about the businesses, we are our own economy. And how do you, you know, how do we let other agents know, hey, listen, you know, we create our business. We got to work on our skill. We, you know, in order for us to be able to create that economy, that no matter what kind of economy we're on, we're still going to make money.
Yeah. So, a few years back, Gil and I, and we haven't really grown out this coaching company the way we should, and we will in the future, but we came up with a concept called the Dead Agent Society, right? And the Dead Agent Society, it was funny because when we first came up with the concept, we couldn't really explain it well. We just loved the name. Like we were just like, the whole concept was that, you know, 87% of agents are out of the business in the first couple of years. Those are the dead agents. And they're probably the best ones to tell you what they did wrong. They know what killed them, right? And if they had secrets to tell you, what would it be, right? But it wasn't an easy one liner, right? It was like we were trying to do this, and I always remember this because we were having a meeting the next day, and it was like Carlos was there, Veronica was there, everybody was this big meeting we were all having. And the night before, I get these amazing ideas in the shower. I don't know why. It's just the shower. I feel like it's just very alone place, water hitting. And I was like, then they're thinking about Dead Agent Society. I was like, man, why can't I have a simple one-liner to kind of express like what we're all about? And then it hit me, and it was like, death of the agent, rise of the real estate entrepreneur. And the next day at the meeting, I said it. And I literally, like, Veronica looked at me. She's like, that's it. That's it right there. That's it. And I was like, did I hit it? Did I get it? And then everybody was like, oh, that's it. And so my thing has been changing agents immediately. So I have a training now called Rise of the Real Estate Entrepreneur. Matter of fact, I'm doing it on Friday. And so we've started to do something called Freedom Fridays, where we'll teach. We have all of our leaders alternate Fridays, and then we teach about an hour on wealth building in general, wealth building within real estate, wealth building. It's not EXP specific. And then we show you what you could do through the platform, through the EXP platform, which, by the way, is the way that I talk to people about it. Like, I don't get rah-rah about brands. I'm not going to sit there and get on some, you know, Facebook argument about whether KW is better. Like, let's not argue about logos. EXP Realty is a wealth building platform for agents. If you show me a better one, I'll look at it. I'm not getting emotional about it, right? It's really what you build on top of that special, right? So we go through that wealth building, and we go through the the EXP explained, which I've been actually tweaking. Now we've been doing this now for 2.5 years, and we've have some results to show. So it's getting kind of fun, you know, and not even just me and Gil's results, but what we're doing is highlighting the people who are in our crew that are having results. Right. So, you know, you might be like, oh, well, Gil and Bobby, they, you know, they're this person. Veronica's this person. Okay. Here's a single mom in the office making $7,000 a month in residual income after 2 years. So that could be you, right? It's just simply by inviting them to the things that we're doing. So I think what to go roundabout to answer your question, it's switching from an employee mindset to an entrepreneurial mindset. And I established that right at the beginning. Hey guys, you are now a business owner. This is your business. You have to stop thinking like you used to think on the employee mindset, that this is you know, some people are like, why'd you get into real estate? Oh, I want to have more free time. Well, somebody lied to you about that shit. All right. But it's your time, right? It's your time, because you have to work in it long enough to create your free time, to create your pockets. So, you know, starting a business is actually harder than having a job. You know, it really is, but it's your business. That's the whole point. It's the difference between renting and buying. Renting, you're just throwing money down the drain. When you own your property, you're paying into it. You're building equity. You're building something for the future. And that's what being an entrepreneur is. So I want to smash that whole, like, hey, you know, you're going to work 9 to 5 and you're going to get a paycheck every 2 weeks. That's not the game you joined. You joined an entrepreneurial game. How do we get you into an entrepreneur mindset where you're understanding that every moment you do this is an investment in your future? And that's the big shift that you have to make with folks, because if you don't talk to them about that at the beginning, they'll start freaking out because they're used to that check every 2 weeks, right? They're going to bug out. They need to understand, hey, that's not how this works, but we're going to make it work if you follow the strategy and plan.
Absolutely. I love it. I don't know. I mean, to me, it's that mindset of, you know, being able to create your own business, like you're saying, you know, that you are the boss. And I think that's hard when you're a new agent and you're starting out, to be able to say, okay, I'm managing my time. Nobody's telling me what to do. That now you just go off, you're doing the laundry, right. This, that, and before you know it, the day is gone. And what did right. You do? So if you had to step back and say, okay, you know, have your kids ask you, hey, what did you do today?
Right.
You know, oh crap, you know, what did I do today? So maybe, you know, having that accountability as to the things that you got to do to make that needle go forward, you know, right. As new agents, that's huge, because it's not just that freedom. That freedom has a price. That's, you know, right.
It's going to be hard. It's going to be hard. And you're going to put in hours. But the thing is that it's like working out, right? You're not going to get results overnight, but if you're consistent, the momentum will build and then you'll be fit. But guess what? Even when you get fit, can you stop training? No, because then you're going to become unfit. So just the idea that the training will never stop. They're never going to be not another level for you to go to. And that mindset actually eases a lot of pressure. Hey, I'm not, you know, I tell the agent sometimes there is no arriving, right? Because you just get to, you get somewhere, you can celebrate where you got, but then you got to set the next level, right? What's the next destination I'm heading to, right? And there's nothing wrong with that. I have a mentor, part of a group called Access. And my mentor says, you know, we're grateful, but not content, you know? So always be grateful for everything you accomplish, everything you push through, but you're not content. There's gotta be more, because here's the deal. Like, I believe everybody has the same goal, right? It's like, I'm doing the presentations. I'm like, hey, you don't have to write down your goals for me. I know what your goals are. Here's your goal. You want to live life on your own terms. That's your goal. It's everybody's goal. Everybody wants to do what they want to do with the people they want to do it with, for the people they want to do it for. You cannot make an impact on your family if you're only worrying about your own personal finances. That's actually the most selfish spot you can be in, is broke, right? Because the only person you think about is you, right? So for me, understanding that financial freedom has to be that foundational thing. You have to be building something that is eventually going to free you. But the first step is building your production business like an entrepreneur. So at first you're fighting. It goes through phases and stages. That's why people are so discouraged sometimes. They don't understand what it looks like. It looks ugly at the beginning, right? When you're fighting your way up, right? It looks a little ugly. But if you do this thing right, what happens is you start putting systems in place in your production business. And now you're starting to create an entrepreneurial structure to even your production. Maybe it's an assistant, maybe it's a CC, maybe it's an ISA. You're doing all these different things so you can actually, so you fight your way up and now you're like, hey man, I can do a lot less and make more. Maybe your next thing is to form a team. Then you form a team and that becomes an income stream. But the beautiful thing about EXP is you can be building your long game retirement right now with agent attraction, with the stock, right? And that's the brilliant thing that has never been introduced to the game. And that's why EXP is growing so fast. I'm like literally a fan of business. I don't go get into shouting magic. Oh, EXP is better than this. I'm like, dude, show me a better platform, because I haven't seen one, right? And it works. And we were just fortunate to join a group that had a lot of success stories. Guys, if you're on this call, I just want you guys to know that, you know, our crew is like not just alliance, but like our lineage is the top lineage in the entire company. Like these are the guys that did it. Jay Kinder, Mike Reese, Dean Frederick, Brent Gove, all these people are a handshake away, and they're the guys that are on stage when we go to these conferences. And matter of fact, now Carlos is on stage and Veronica is on stage. And Rosemary's on. I mean, how cool is it that you go to a 6,000 person conference and your homies are up there on the stage? I mean, that is an opportunity that I don't think is stressed enough. It's like, you know, EXP is a brilliant platform on its own, but you guys are part of something big. So what do you guys have to do? Let's tap into it. Don't waste that opportunity. Don't waste it, you know? Go learn everything you can, meet these guys, go to these events, shake their hands so you can see that it's real for you. Because this is honestly, sometimes I'm like, I can't even believe like we're even part of this thing. Like I was front row with Tony Robbins like a month ago. Like he was walking by, like Tony Robbins doesn't even do private events. And Brent Go was able to get this guy to do, you know what I mean? That's some really, really cool stuff. You just got to understand what you're a part of and keep buying in, stick with it.
Does anybody have any questions for Bobby, because I know we're a little over time, but we tend to do that a lot. We get carried away and it gets exciting. So like sometimes we're out of here at like 7. So anyways, anybody got any questions? Anybody?
I do not, but thank you for coming and speaking with all of us, Bobby.
Absolutely. My pleasure. My pleasure. Anytime, guys. I love hanging out with my crew, you know? When did we meet the first time, Lisset, in that one model home, that yes, one we time we came down?
We did. Yes.
That was a fun memory. That was early on. And I remember Veronica going, hey, I need you to come to this place. Help me out with EXP and explaining it. And I'm like, all right, cool. I didn't know what I was walking into. And it was a whole new construction model home full of women. And she's like, all right, Bobby, go in there. I'm like, first of all, this is awesome. Second of all, I didn't know I was going to be doing a presentation today, but I'm happy to be here. And then I met all you amazing folks. So blessed that we can be in partnership together.
And that's what I love about, you know, even that mindset of like, you know what, sometimes life throws uncomfortable. Just even if you don't want to do it, just do it, because that's like life telling you, if you do this, you're going to grow to that next level. And some people freeze up and they're afraid and they don't do it. But, you know, they don't realize even that phone call to someone that, hey, you know, you expired, you know, how can I help you? Some people freeze up and just have that mindset, guys, we're here just to help everybody out. And don't be afraid, because the moment you're afraid, you're freezing up and you're going to fail. You know, you're just basically, you know, at least you did it. If you failed, get up again and let's do it all over again. Yeah.
Build that uncomfortable muscle. You know, I mean, that's what it is really about. Like when you look at it that way, rather than say, I got to make this uncomfortable phone call or Veronica throwing me up in front of people I don't know. It's, you know, I look at it different. I was like, well, you know, let's build this muscle today, right? Like, let's figure this thing out, you know, and it does take practice. Look, guys, all the people you see that are successful in your group have been practicing for a long time, you know, so understand that it is consistent practice. It's consistent getting uncomfortable. Like, Gil was like, hey, I want you to start a coaching program for the office called Talent Development Program. And that was 4 years ago. Well, at that point in time, he's like, okay, and you got to teach every Thursday. So sometimes I was teaching on Tuesdays and Thursdays for four hours of seminar a week for months. I was having to create my own content. I was having to do all these things, but I knew, even though it was a lot of work at the time, and I was like, oh my gosh, I'm getting strong. Like, I'm getting to the point, like I used to bug out when somebody's like, oh, I need you to go like do a presentation in like a week. I'm like, a week? Like, I need time to prepare. I need to memorize everything. I need to put everything together. I need to whatever. And like now it's like, if I had to do something on the fly for like 3 hours, I'd be like, nope, just tell me what I got to do. You know what I'm saying? And like, I could put that together, but I only came with all that repetition, you know? And I know it's like, repetition is the most non-sexy thing that there is, but it is really the thing, right? It's just doing it and doing it and doing it. And yes, and then it gets easier, right? And then you have that muscle built, and it's the same thing with your real estate business and all the stuff that you're doing. Find something that you want to be great at in real estate that's going to make you money and get you that production going, and then just attack it. You know, and it's going to be clunky and you're going to suck at first, and then you're going to get better, and then you're going to get ideas, and it's going to refine. And then before you know it, 6 months later, you're like, people are asking you to teach a class about it. Like, hey, can you teach a class? And like, dude, 6 months ago, I was like crapping my pants trying to, you know, to even start this thing. And look at you now. And all of us started that way. You know, I mean, you've got stories, Patty's got stories, you know, Kaylin's got stories. Everybody's got stories just like that.
Well, any questions, guys? Before we let Bobby go, I want to respect his time, but just want to make sure that we have any questions that you might have.
I think Bobby did pretty well about covering everything. Excuse the My Little Pony song that just came on. My daughter's with me.
Mine is one of my favorites.
Right. But you've been pretty energetic and hit every nail on the head, so I think you've summed it up.
I appreciate that, guys. Well, it's always a pleasure. And, you know, let's see each other soon.
Absolutely. Thanks so much.
All right, guys.
Yes, thank you.
Stay tuned for Lisset and Patty having our power hour every Monday at 6 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. We're going to have our monthly schedule out here soon for October already. October. That's crazy. Time is flying by.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, Bobby, for your time. And guys, see you next week.
All right. Bye. Bye.